Good morning, everybody. Can we give it up one more time for them kids? Wow. I want to thank Amy and Dawn for all their hard work working with these children and just the music. You two are awesome. Thank you once again, you guys. Just give me one moment here to get my other two singers up here. You're coming. If you have your hymnals, if you would, please. Turn to hymn number 452, and stand if you are able. This song is called My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Greet one another with passing in the peace. May the Lord be with you and also with you. What a beautiful bunch of people we have here today. We've definitely been blessed. If you would, turn to hymn number 405, Seek Ye First.
Oh. You may be seated. I invite you to quiet your minds and to quiet your hearts as we go to the Lord in prayer. God, we come to you today knowing what you want us to do, but we are far too often hesitant to follow through for you. You give us multiple blessings and ask that we develop the gifts and use them to help others. In times of crisis, we come through and we step up to the plate. However, in the intermediate times, we hold back. We often develop a let somebody else do it attitude. We often think of our gifts and our talents as things that are less than worthy. In this country in which competition is the ruling code, we don't want to compete with others because we feel we just don't have the right stuff. How blind we are, Lord. To each of us, you have given us gifts which can be used to help others. Each gift and talent is precious in your sight. Rather than compete with others to see who has the greater talent, help us to use the gifts we have been given joyfully. One of the greatest gifts you have given us is the gift of prayer. And we bring before you, Lord, the concerns which have been weighing on our hearts. Touch the lives of all these peoples and situations with your healing love. Give each one a sense of your powerful presence. Flood their lives with hope and peace. Help each of us to be workers for you. Help us to trust you in your abiding presence and your love for us. Challenge us to use the gifts and to honor the giver. For we ask these things in the name of Christ. Amen.
Good morning, y'all. Good morning. Today, we are going to be continuing in the book of Mark as we have been. And this morning, we're particularly going to be talking about what it means to be a servant leader. Now, in our culture, we like the leader part of that statement, right? I can tell you from the earliest part of my childhood, I was trained and bred to lead. I remember my first baseball practices that I can remember because I've played baseball since before I could remember when I was a child. One of the first speeches we got from the coach every year was about attitude and effort and about how leaders have good attitude and effort every day. I was taught a lot of great leadership lessons, and through my life I've continued to receive incredible leadership lessons. But sometimes our culture forgets to emphasize that servant part of the Christian calling, the call to serve. And very often when we get wrapped up in being leaders, the sin of pride takes over. How many of you have ever had a moment where you were just a little too proud? I'm glad you didn't leave me hanging on this one. I appreciate it. Because there are moments when our pride gets the better of us. There are moments when our pride makes us less than who we're called to be. There are moments when our pride and desire to receive accolades, to receive comments that are positive, to receive essentially reciprocal love and affection for the things we do overcome our willingness to serve. And I can tell you that this is not only true for Christians, but it's true for Christians in churches that sit in the pews, but it's true for pastors too. Pride is something I actively struggle with because humility is the only place we can lead as Christians from, a place where, yes, we lead, but we lead as those who serve. But I can tell you there are moments when my ego gets the better of me. I don't think I'm alone in that. When people have said too many nice things to me in a row, right? When I think that I am hot stuff. And the good news is I have an accountability team that keeps me in check. First and foremost, my wife takes care of that. She doesn't mind telling me when I'm getting a little bit too much. My children keep me humble. They remind me of all the things that are wrong with me all the time. And my staff here at this church is awesome. They don't mind looking at me and going, "Now, David, you know better than that." And it's good. It's good to have a network of people and church members and lay people and all kinds of people who are willing to gently and lovingly, knowing that they have my best interest at heart, come alongside me and say, hey, your spirit on this might be wrong. I need to talk to you. And what that does is it creates space for that servant leadership to grow and to flourish. And we're going to talk a little bit about what it means to be servant leaders and why we're servant leaders. Because the argument that I would make is that if you are a professing Christian, if you've received the waters of baptism and you've decided you're going to follow Christ, you're called to servant leadership. And so we're going to talk a little bit about what that looks like. In the book of Mark chapter 1, beginning with verse 29, it says this. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. Jesus came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door, and Jesus cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. This scripture is somewhat of a troubling one because Jesus has just called his disciples. He's taught in the synagogue. The last 2 weeks we talked about those scriptures, how Jesus called his disciples. It was miraculous how when he taught, he astounded and amazed people as he brought new insight and understanding. And then he goes to Simon's house, and at this house, Simon Peter's mother-in-law is sick. She's got a fever, and Jesus, it says, he goes to the side of her bed and grabs her hand, and he heals her. And that's a wonderful story, right? We love that story. But the next sentence always troubles me. And so she got up and served them. Could they not make their own snacks? This woman had a fever. She needed to rest. There was a lot going on. And I always read this scripture and would scratch my head and go, why did she have to do that? And so often we think of things in those terms. Why do I have to do something? I would argue that she wanted to do something and that she looked at it as an opportunity where she got to do something. She didn't want to be sick in bed with a fever. She wanted to be well so she could do the things that she was called to do. So when she was well, she got back to work doing what she felt like was her calling. She began serving immediately. And I think about this when I think about our Christian walk, because there's so often where we as Christians get caught up in this idea of what we have to do to be Christians. Oh, I have to go to church. Oh, I have to pray. Oh, I have to tithe. Oh, I have. What have we talked about? It as we got to do those things. I know in my walk with ministry, there not everything that I do is fun. Counter to popular belief. A lot of people think that being a pastor is every day is sunshine and rainbows and that the Lord speaks directly to me and it's all wonderful. That is not how it works. I invite you to come hang out with me for a day and see how it works and you'll be grateful for your job. But there is a reality that it's a messy business doing church. It's not always clean. It's not always simple. It's not always easy. But I look at it not as something I have to do, but something I get to do. Because that changes my perspective on it. I get to sit with people in their final moments and hold their hands and comfort them. And I've done that many times. I get to go to endless meetings about church business. But what's amazing about those meetings is we're seeing the work of the church get done. I get to go and visit with people. I get to go into freezing cold waters in the Gulf and baptize people. So many people came and they're like, why'd you do that? I was like, because I got to. It's awesome. There's so much about our job that is incredible about being a Christian. It's not just about being a pastor, but the things that we get to be a part of. Do you realize we get to be a part of seeing what God is doing in the world? We get to be a part of it. And Jesus lived his life that way, where he wasn't this kind of person who just sat back on his laurels and let everyone praise him. He stayed on task. He kept working. He kept going. As soon as Simon's mother was healed and she was serving the disciples, crowds show up at this house. And Jesus immediately, after teaching all day in the synagogue, goes and starts healing people and casting out demons, which I think that would be very fun to watch. To watch people's entire lives be transformed. To watch unclean spirits leave people. To watch Jesus overcome things that people thought were impossible, to see people's lives that everyone viewed as a burden become a blessing because whatever was holding them back and stopping them from being who God needed to be was taken away, and all that was left was this incredible soul formed in the image of God, ready to serve. That's an incredible moment. And I would imagine for Jesus, that moment was overwhelming, even as he knew who he was. He knew who his Father was. It wasn't like he was confused about what he was called to do. But the temptation to just stay in a place where people loved you must have been overwhelming. Because all these crowds that would come to him, they would almost swarm him. And as you read through Scripture, you realize that these crowds didn't really like to leave him alone. They wanted Jesus to help them in the midst of their suffering and their struggles. They wanted Jesus to give them hope. They wanted Jesus to make them whole, to solve their problems. And Jesus was really there to spark hope and to create people who not only would have some of their, yes, struggles resolved by Christ, but also to be a part of what Jesus was doing. Our scripture tells us that as he was casting out demons, he wouldn't even let them talk because he didn't want people to really know who and what he was. He just wanted to serve. He didn't do his job for celebrity status. He didn't do his job so that way he could achieve a certain career goal. He didn't do his job because it one thing led to this thing and led to that thing. He wasn't climbing a ladder. He wasn't seeking to be anything other than what he was. And what he was God's Son sent to save us. And so he continually chose the mission over the potential rewards the mission would have given him. He continually chose to serve. And our scripture tells us that after he heals all those people, he goes out into a deserted place to pray. He goes away from all these crowds who would very likely have built him a house and anything he wanted and kept him right there with them because, I mean, why wouldn't you, right? And how many of us, if we had the ability to heal people and take care of people, how many of us would not use that? Perhaps in a way that served us. Maybe we were trying to serve people, but it would serve us as well. But Jesus didn't do that. When the crowds would get too big, when the love for him would get overwhelming, when they would be cheering and shouting for him, he would go off to a deserted and quiet place, recenter, refocus himself, and he would gather his disciples and say, "Let's go on to the next town," which is exactly what he did. His mission was to tell everyone that the time had come near, that it was time for people to experience a new way of engaging with their God, a new way of living out their life of faith. He was reaching out to people who weren't just the normal people that you would find in churches. He was reaching out to people whose lifestyles led to other places, and he was healing and loving on these people, indiscriminate of their history, of their background, of where they came from. He was just helping. And that sounds pretty refreshing, doesn't it? Because most of the time in the world that we have today, there are a lot of incredible places that try to help people, but there's always this caveat. We'll help you with all these things if, and then there's the fine print. Or there's, we'll help these kinds of people, but not these kinds. And so there's this weird experience that goes on in the life of faith where we put conditions around our service. I would argue that the church has not always done a great job of being the kind of people who really are Christians. The word Christian means little Christ. And if we look at Jesus' ministry, the question I would have is, when is the one time that Jesus looked at someone and said, go away, I'm not helping you? Now, there are moments where people walk away from Jesus and don't want his help, but when did Jesus say, no, I won't? He helped everybody. But there's a temptation, right? This temptation that lives in our heart to be prideful, this temptation that exists in us that pushes us to clearly define the boundaries of God's grace, to clearly define who is worthy, to clearly define the limits of the requirement of Jesus on our lives. But there is no limit. Jesus said, if you want to follow me, pick up your cross and come on. What he basically said was, your life will not be your own. It will belong to the kingdom. Your life will be given in service to God. Because many of the people Jesus was healing and helping, very often he would look at them and say, now go and serve God. Now go and be who God wants you to be. Go and be the person that you can be. I don't think all of them lived perfectly. I don't think all of them got it right, but Jesus' intention was to give these chances for people to become who God needed them to be. The Apostle Paul kind of illuminates this text a little bit in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning with verse 16, and it says this, if I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me. And woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this thing of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. This letter from Paul is one where he is very clearly telling people who are criticizing perhaps his ministry or criticizing the kinds of people who are walking in the doors of their church, he's very clearly telling them, you know what I've done in my missionary journey? I've walked alongside anybody who would listen. Anyone who would profess Jesus Christ as Lord, I walked beside them. I shared hope with them. I gave them everything I could. I served them. And even though they weren't all like Paul, he served them anyway. He served Jews. He served people under the law. He served Christians who were outside from under the law. He served slaves. He served the weak. He served even those in positions of power. And you know what Paul ended up doing? Just starting like a ton of churches. Just saving thousands of souls. Just creating the vehicle by which the church would have this ability to make a difference in the world. But it starts with service. It starts with being willing to serve. And serving in a way that is not only propping ourselves up, but is instead a humble service used to further the kingdom of God, for the kingdom of God first and foremost. And that's tough. Augustine of Hippo was a rock star theologian. I don't know if you've read his books. There are a lot of them. But Augustine of Hippo was a bishop in the church, and he wrote one very scathing letter to bishops once upon a time. Because there were bishops who were serving themselves. They were using their position of power to further themselves over the ministry of the churches that they had. And he basically told them that they were behaving as less than Christians, because Augustine believed that this pride that these bishops had was the root of all evil, and it was the root of all evil in all Christians, that pride and this disability to not experience humility overwhelmed their ability to serve. They served themselves because they were too proud in their positions. St. Gregory the Great, I know I'm talking about a lot of old guys right now, but St. Gregory the Great wrote a book called The Book of Pastoral Rule, and it was aimed at preachers. And if you read the book, it's an incredible book because it's one that I lean on heavily as a pastor, because it's all about what does it look like to serve a congregation? What does it look like to be the right kind of leader? And I very often, St. Gregory steps all over my toes, and I just have to live with it. But one of the things he said was that true pastors are people who come to the living waters, and they receive this living water that's clear and pure, and they receive it from the clearest and purest source. But so often, even we pastors are tempted by this sin of pride. And instead of imbibing this pure source, this clear water of truth, we stick our muddy feet in it and corrupt it. And St. Gregory argued that we pastors, and I would argue that all of us who view ourselves as Christians, who are also Christian leaders, have to be careful. We have to be careful in the way that we treat others with our faithfulness. We have to be careful in the way that we serve. We have to be careful not to corrupt the stream of truth that we've been given, but instead to share it. To share it as joyful people, as people who receive God's grace and God's goodness, as imperfect people who have been formed by the perfecting grace of God, as imperfect people who are called to a purpose. One of the incredible things about the entire Bible is it's the story of imperfect people meeting this perfect God and what their lives walking alongside God are like. They don't always get it right, but I would argue from Genesis to the book of Revelation, what God is doing is he's gathering up these imperfect vessels and forming them into something beautiful and incredible. They still sometimes have flaws. They still sometimes have cracks, but ultimately he forms them into people who do good work, who represent the body of Christ in the world. And I would argue God is still doing that with the church today. We're not perfect. We don't get it all right. We don't always serve as we're called to serve, but we can be better. One of the things I love about this church is how much we try to serve. I love our backpack ministry where we feed kids every weekend. I love our thrift store where we go and we essentially take things that would have ended up maybe in a landfill somewhere and we repurpose them and then we sell them, and all the dollars we generate go to serve the mission of this church, to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. We help people. We do things that are incredible. I love that we have bed builds, that we've done one bed build. We got another one scheduled in April. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Because those beds go to kids in our county who don't have anywhere to sleep. We put them in a bed. We got to deliver some of those beds a week ago, and the pictures of that are just beautiful. These excited children knowing that they've been given somewhere to sleep and knowing that people they've never met from our church made it happen. And we don't do these things to serve ourselves. We do them so that God's kingdom might grow, that people might have hope, that there might be at least a spark of curiosity, of faithfulness in people. We do it so that even if they don't come to our church, that they know that Christians are good people and they might go to a church. Amen? I want people in a church. Yes, we want to catch our fair share of fish, but there's enough for everybody. We got to figure out how to make God come alive. And it's going to take every single one of us serving. It's going to take every single one of us deciding that God has called us to a ministry that is incredible. And it's not that we have to do it, but that we get to do it. And we get to see God work in our world. We get to see the movement of the Spirit. We get to see God work in real time, because those who have eyes to see and ears to hear get to see and hear incredible things each and every day. But you got to look for it. And one of the things that Jesus taught us was that we're not called to just spend too much time on just one area, but as we meet a need one place, we're called to find another need and go to it. We're called to constantly be going and not tarrying around. John Wesley would say, never tarry on one task more time than it takes. It's part of my ordination vow, was to not waste time. but instead to see the needs and then go and serve them. To be willing to be deployed missionally, to serve missionally. So when Jesus healed Simon Peter's mother, she was excited because she got to serve. That's what I think. That's the gospel according to David. And when I think about my own life, I can tell you, I'm excited because I get to serve. And what makes me the most excited is being alongside other people who are excited because they get to serve. It's infectious. And what happens when we joyful Christians serve alongside each other? Do you know what happens? The world changes. And it changes for the better. It becomes more like the world that is to come than the world as it is. So friends, I encourage you, think about what it looks like in your life to lean into your faith a little bit more. What are places in your spiritual maturity where you're lagging? Where are places where you haven't really bought in? And think about what it means to take the next faithful step and to serve as people who have been made one and whole with Christ. Because God's grace has been given to us. Our salvation is assured. And with that gift, we have been given something incredible. We've given life that will never wear out, a hope that will never be taken away. We have some people in our church who have been serving. I don't know if you've noticed our altar this morning, but there are a lot of prayer quilts and prayer patches, and there are some knit blankets that we want to give to Family Promise on our altar. And these gifts that we have are things that have been prayed over. We have launched a new ministry with Cindy Stillwell and Paula Rohn. If you want to be a part of it, you can talk to them. But this new ministry that we have started is one where we're going to intentionally be taking some of these items to people as they become ill and giving them these. And these have been prayed over. And for every knot that is in the central thing, that's a prayer that's been prayed over this. And so people can tie knots and eventually it'll be all full of knots where people have prayed. But these prayer squares are meant to be an outward sign of the grace and love of our church. As we go and we're with people who are struggling and facing adversity in their lives, these are at least a symbol to people that there are church people praying for them daily, that there are church members that are caring for them, and that we are praying that God be with them. And if we can serve them in other ways, we will. But this is just a small way where we can share God's love with people. And so after the service, I invite you to come and take one of these if you would like, to share with someone who needs hope in your life. But these things are a way that we serve. They're a way that we share God's goodness and God's mercy with the world. And so as we think about what it means to serve, let's think about ways that we can be deployed. Let's think about ways that we can share God's goodness and mercy in the world. And let's think about how we can help people experience the goodness and love of God that each and every one of us have. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we pray this morning that you would help us as we seek to be people of service to you and to each other. Help us to be humble and to not let pride get in our way. But help us, God, to see that you've called us and that we get to be a part of the incredible work that you're doing. We ask for all of this in your holy name. Amen. I invite those assisting in Holy Communion to come forward right now. And if you would, join with me on the screens as we begin Holy Communion by celebrating with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by the water and the Spirit. And on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he broke the bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here. On these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray with the confidence of the children of God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
our ushers come forward, we again celebrate, as David previously said, our weekend feeding program for children and youth in our community. More than 450 young people are fed each week because of your generosity. Let us pray. There are no limits to the gifts you have given us, gracious Lord. Now we return thanks to you for these gifts, and we bring these tokens to you, asking for your blessing on the givers and the gifts. Help these gifts and givers to be your witnesses throughout the world. Amen.
Amen. God is such a great thing. During the communion, I had a chance to just, the choir here, we were looking out at the congregation, and we just would like to say, wow, y'all are beautiful. For some of you who have started with us with the traditional service from day one, you can see God's work. I mean, just by trusting in God, believing in Him, and being very patient, you see things happening. For example, you folks right out here. We first started, there was only 5 to 10 people, if that, at times. And it was just myself and a guitar and playing traditional music. Now look what we have. This is God's work. This is great. This is great, the choir that we have here, my piano player. So, Lord, we trust in you 100%. Thank you so much. This song is called Trust in God. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood, and what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. 'Cause I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. So this is my story, and this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. 'Cause I trust in God, my Savior, trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him. That's why I trust Him. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered.
answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered.
That's why trust him. That's why I trust in God.
If you would, please turn to hymn number 172, My Jesus. Man, we really, really love you.